It was supposed to be 48 on Thursday, but a funny thing happened on my way there. This stopped beating. It just became still. Not quite sure why. Suddenly all the humor went out of my life. Nobody was talking to me. And improv just became something that was really strange, because improv's supposed to be done in a group. You're supposed to be able to do orchestrated stories and have people point at you, and you start telling a story that's really awesome. And then somebody else is supposed to take over. Or you're supposed to be able to do a scene with somebody and be able to give them a wonderful offer. But it doesn't quite work. Nobody talks back to you. But a couple of days ago, I started hearing a voice.
That's right, John. I'm here.
And it's back.
I'm always here.
It's the improv god. And he had a challenge for me.
John, I have a challenge for you. Your challenge is to meet everyone in your life who's ever meant anything to you, John. The only challenge is you won't know them as you know them now. You see? Oh, go ahead.
Always been told that I talk too much and I interrupt people. Go ahead, oh improv god.
Oh, okay, if you say so. What I'm going to do, John, I'm going to allow you two pieces of information for each of the people that I have gathered.
All right.
And that's all. If you succeed, then you will continue improv. If you fail, John, you're doomed to a life behind a keyboard.
So I'll have to sing you a song like the Piano Man?
I hate Billy Joel.
So how much time do I have to do this?
Starting right now, John, 45 minutes. Or what seems like 45 minutes. It could be like Inception, where time is like double.
I guess I better get started then. It's been a lot of life spent in 48 years. And apparently, the improv god has brought everybody that means something to me here to the audience. But I can only remember two things about each one of you. It's hard to see faces within the spotlight, but I think, oh my God, you are here. You look a lot different with your beard and mustache, but you're my childhood friend that I grew up with. What's your name?
Brandon.
Brandon. Oh my gosh. You grew up well. Is this who you married?
Not yet.
Not yet? Are you gonna get married though?
I don't wanna spoil the surprise.
He always had a thing for brunettes. Brandon, do you remember how we met? Just tell me a little bit about how we met, because I can't remember. He took everything from me.
We met in middle school, and it was a Monday, first day of class. We were in science class.
Oh, gosh, I do remember that. I do remember that. Why are they teaching the sex education in middle school? On our first day? I at least hope that there's nice people. It's my first day at this school ever. Kids always picked on me in elementary school. I went to this elementary school that was in a small town, and then we moved to the big city. And in elementary school, I was always the tallest one in the entire school, not the tallest boy or the tallest girl, but the tallest one in the entire elementary school. I was 5'8" in elementary school. And I had a friend there that I left, and it was so hard leaving him because he was the only person that was nice to me. Because everybody always made fun of the big guy. See, big guys always get blamed for everything. Have you ever noticed that? Cars will drive by in the snow, and all the people back here will be having a snowball fight, and a snowball will come way from the back and hit a Mercedes-Benz that's driving by, and they go, oh, come out of the car and go, you big guy, why did you throw a snowball at my car? No, it wasn't me. I'm a gentle guy. No, you must have done it. You're the biggest guy here. It was the bad kid back there. Well, you look pretty bad to me. You're pretty big. I wasn't as fat then, by the way. I was skinny. I can't even get that skinny anymore. But they always blame the big guy. So now I go into this middle school. It's the first day. Our first class was science. They were teaching sex education. In walks Brandon. How uncomfortable could it possibly be to have your first class on your first day, you know no one, they're teaching sex education, and you have to say hello to somebody for the very first time? Hello? My name's John. Yeah, we moved here from a small town in Texas. Yeah. Brandon. Oh, hi. Nice to. You've lived here a long time. Yeah. I'm kind of uncomfortable too talking to you about sex education. Yeah. Girls, they kind of freak me out, the cooties and all that. You like brunettes. Oh. Well, maybe you and I will be friends someday. Aaron, and ended up being my very good friend for an awful long time after that. It was pretty nice because all through middle school, when kids tried to beat me up, you were the one that was standing next to me. I remember that all now, and I thank you for that. Wow, it's amazing who you... Improv God, you really did put people here like that. Who else is here tonight? No, it couldn't be. Brandon, did you know she was here? I may be 48, but I feel like I'm 14 again. Rebecca was my first crush. Who did you end up marrying?
I ended up marrying him.
Oh, the comedian.
The British guy.
A drama geek. Turn the princess over back to you, Your Highness. This is is actually turning out to be pretty fun, improv god. My childhood friend and my first crush. Wow. Seems to be a... It was all positive. Tell everybody your name.
It's John. Just like yours.
And you always said to everybody that you were the only one allowed to be named John in the entire school, didn't you?
Well, just like Highlander, there could be only one.
And what did I have to change my name to?
I gave you a list. Gunga Din.
Yeah.
Gunga Din.
And the one I chose was? Gunga Din. Captain of the football team. Captain of the wrestling team. Captain of the school. Captain of the universe. Captain of the Titanic. I just wanted to throw that one in to see if you were listening.
You forgot Snappy Dresser.
Snappy Dresser.
I'm Gunga Din, not Tim Gunn.
Okay, you got it there.
All the ladies got that. At least the younger ones. Hold on, I'll have to put my glasses on like this and say, not Tim Gunn. You bullied me all through high school. Why?
I never thought about it.
I'll tell you why. Stand up. That's why. Little inferiority complex, maybe. You wanted to feel a little special.
I just wanted to dance with you.
Do we have any appropriate music up there, perhaps? It might take a while, but the improv gods have a great iPod.
I hate to be a bummer, John. 15 minutes in. Just saying.
If my heart was moving, it would be beating real fast right now. Luckily, it's not. So I couldn't be oh. Nobody's gonna wanna hug me now. But I'm glowing. Hi, Mrs. Jones. You still won't say hello? You're still upset that I ran over your cat? Those are the only two things I remember. What you have and what you're wearing is actually reminding me of things. The fact that you have a very muscular man with a sword on it reminds me of what you tried to do to me after I ran over your cat with my bicycle. And I'm happy to say that I still had children afterwards. The fact that you had a regular Coke with you reminds me of something. That the fact that you got me hooked on regular Coke allowed me to be like this. You were the nicest lady on the block until I ran over your cat and you just couldn't forgive me. But you know something, Mrs. Jones? I understand why. Because you loved that cat, didn't you? It was the most important thing in your life. It was the one thing that kept you company. It kept you warm at night. It sat on your lap while you watched television. It's the one that you told your deepest secrets to. It's the one was your best friend, and I ran over it with a bicycle. And being as young as I was, I had no idea what it meant. I had no idea what kind of bond there could be between a cat and a human being. It's sometimes stronger than human beings and human beings. How long did you cry after that?
6 years.
Sorry. I I know it's been over 40 years. I know it's been over 40 years. But can you accept my apology? I hope you haven't chased anybody out of that sort, though. Yeah. Oh. No. Okay.
Yeah.
These lights are so bright. You should be used to them by now. San Antonio. White Rose Formal. 1985. I can't remember your name. And it's not because I don't want to, it's because he took it away. And I'm not crying because I can't remember your name. I'm still trying to get over Mrs. Jones. What's your name?
Carrie.
Hi, Carrie. Gosh, I remember you. You wore this most exquisite white dress. Just by seeing your face, I remember that white dress. Can you remind me what sorority you were in? You weren't anything if you weren't a Greek. The Greeks ruled the skull. The Greeks were the jacks. The Greeks were everything the Greeks ruled. Cars. The Greeks were the people that you wanted to be. The Greeks were the people you wanted to be with. And I happened to be one. Go on in life, as you go on in school, you realize it's something you may not want to be. And after taking her to the formal, and everybody started looking down on me because I took an independent, I had the gall to take an independent to the formal. As the British would say, a commoner. They kicked me out of the fraternity. Gone. In my senior year, 4 months from graduating. 4 months. I was a straight A student. I had given some of my own money to the fraternity. My grandfather was a member of the fraternity and was a member of their board. And they kicked me out because she meant more to me than any three Greek letters on my chest. That helped make me who I am now. So I may not be at the top of the Lehman Brothers building. Oh, wait a minute, there isn't one of those, is there? I may not be on top of the Goldman Sachs. I may not be on top of the MC. I may be not be on top of the. Well, gosh darn it, that's where all my fraternity brothers ended up. Instead, I'm on an improv stage talking to you all, except for the guy who works for Enron who just walked up. I'm sorry to have offended, sir. You see, when the improv god talked about people who meant something to me, who shaped my lives, who shaped my life, I'm not a cat yet. Little did we know that just one date, because that's all we had was that one date, that just one date would shape my life. And then he brought you here. I haven't seen you since that night. It was a lovely date, we just didn't have great chemistry. Because I could see the way you were looking at me now. Nah, he's not gonna look at me. Carrie. But the fact is, that one day shaped who I am. And I thank you for that. I said I got married to a wonderful one. She couldn't be here tonight, unfortunately, because she's home taking care of two very wonderful kids who I will miss very much. But luckily, in the back over there, there he is my son's soccer coach. I recognize him because it's hard to miss his bald head. I when I first met him, I thought it was a soccer ball. Yeah. How are you, sir?
Doing well.
Remind me what your name is.
It's Mark.
Hi, Mark. Hi. Tell me your first recollection of meeting my son.
Well, I think that was when he kicked the soccer ball into their kid's head.
My son I'd love to call him a mischief maker, but he's not. My son is a good kid. But every now and then he'll do something like kick a ball into another kid's head. And all the kids around him will laugh. And he'll start going, like it's the funniest thing in the world. And all the kids around him, it's like, ah! And the kids will stop laughing, and he'll turn around and they'll go, and when the kids go to the other side of the field, my son will quietly walk over to the kid who got hit in the back of the head and go, kid might be crying. It really hurt. Because this happened when he was six. It really hurt. I want mom. My son would say things like, it'll be okay. You want to get ice cream? Meanwhile, the other kids on the other side are all doing something like this.
That kid's such a doof as he took it in the back of his hand like that. He must be such a retard. He must be gay. He must be this. He must be that.
Am I? Little guy is looking at him, them like this. These are his teammates, you understand. These are the people that he's supposed to like. This is a guy on the opposite team that he just bonked in the head. And these are the people that are supposed to have his back. Sometimes you have to make choices. I am so proud of the fact that he takes care of a person that he might have hurt instead of continuing to hurt. And if I remember correctly, Mark, you helped teach him that by making an example from your past life when that happened to you when you were a kid. Because you were the guy that got hit with the ball, weren't you?
Yes, I think it was you that hit me with the ball.
That's what it was. And did I come take care of you?
No, I think it was Brandon that actually came over and helped me. But I know you're thinking about it.
But the head of the kids that were making fun of you? Stand up, John.
I just wanted to dance with you, man.
We're getting towards the end of what I knew as my life. And there's one person in here. There's one person, I just know there's one person in here. Improv God, how much time do I have?
Well, John, it's a little over 10 minutes. Make it count.
There's one person in here that had to come a long way to be here. And I would never expect in a million years that they would be here. And I'm almost scared to come down from the stage to see if they're here, because if they are here, it would be the greatest thing to ever happen to me. And the improv God promised me that all the important people in my life are in this audience. That's what he promised me. But if I cross that line, if I cross those 2 inches right there, there's no barrier there, nothing to keep me from crossing it, nothing at all. Nice padded carpet on the other side, even stairs to help me there. If I cross it and that person isn't there, there's no reason for this thing to start ever again. Can anyone understand how difficult that is? Can anyone understand the disappointment that can bring? The anticipation of the greatest thing in your life being right there, a step away, but being so scared to take it. For me, it was starting an improv group. I took the step, and for 6 months, it was the greatest thing in the world. It was a family. And then it got to be work. And then it got to be sacrifice. And suddenly it became, yes and became, yes oh hell. And then I said, goodbye. Not gonna do it anymore. And this broke. And I didn't know what to do. And that's when it stopped. So what do I do if I cross that line and that person's not out there? Someone once told me, take your balls out of your purse and just do it. So let's see if they're there. You know what I realized? It doesn't matter if they're there. It doesn't matter a bit if they're there. Because every single one of you is here. Every single one of you sharing this moment in time with me. Every single one of you is now my friend. Some of you I have known from before. Some of you I've met for the first time tonight. Some of you I've loved for a long time. Some of you I've known and become really good friends with. Some of you have given me my heart. I can't thank you enough for allowing me to bring an improvised life back to you. this may not have been the laugh fest that you might have expected, but what I hope you take from this is never underestimate the power of what you can do for somebody else just by being there for them. You can make that difference every day for somebody, whether you know them or not. It's a moment I'll never forget, and a moment I owe all to you.